We are on to the pre-formulation, and in case of pre-formulation, we were on the chemical properties. And while studying the chemical properties, we had gone through the oxidation, reduction, hydrolysis, racemization, and polymerization. And in the last lecture, we ended our topic with the polymers, but that was incomplete, and today we will continue with the same, that is polymerization. Now, while studying the polymerization, we said that there is a monomer. So when monomer multiple times they will join with each other, they will form the polymer. And there are various examples of the polymers which we are using in case of pharmaceutical dosage form manufacturing. Now, we have studied the example of the styrene. When multiple styrene molecule, styrene is the monomer, when multiple styrene they will join with each other, they will form the polystyrene. Now, how these polymers are used and what are their mechanism by which they will going to act? The particular mechanism of action of the polymer which will acting as a hydrophilic polymers, what they will do, they will react with water, and when they react with water, they will get swollen, they will form a swollen network that is formed in the presence of the cross-linking agent. Now, when they will come in contact with that of the water, they swell in water, but they cannot get dissolved because of this stable cross-linking. So what they will do is they will just get swollen. And that's why they are used in the formulation of the floating tablet and the implants in case of the pharmaceutical dosage forms. So these are responsible for helping in the process of prolonging the release of drugs. Prolonging, that means extending the duration. These are also used, the polymers are also used in case of enteric coating tablets. Now, enteric coating, these are the tablet which will not get disintegrated into the stomach, but they will get disintegrated into the intestine. So what are the examples of the polymers that are used in order to coat the tablet and which could be used as an enteric coating tablet? The examples are the cellulose acetate halate, hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose halate, copolymers of methacrylic acid and their esters, and polyvinyl acetate phthalate. So all these are the examples of the agents which could be used in order to build the enteric coating. So as a result of which, what will happen? They do not dissolve over the gastric pH range, but they will get dissolved rapidly at the less acidic pH, that is about the value 5. Polymers, they are also used in case of the colonic delivery system. Colonic delivery system, it is a kind of drug delivery system where particularly, targetively, we are giving the drug, we are introducing the drugs into the colons and not into the stomach and not into the intestine. That is said to be the colonic drug delivery system. That is the large intestine, that is the cecum. So here we are using the pH sensitive polymers. We are using the combination of the polymers, say in the form of Udragit 100 to 55 along with the Udragit 5U or Udragit S. So Udragit 100 55, which will be having the pH of 5.5, and the Udragit S that will be having the pH of 7. The polymer, these are also used to coat the drug delivery system with a polymer that is sensitive to the bacteria in the colon. So the drug that will be protected into the intestine, it will be protected into the stomach, but it will get released only in case of the colon, which will get attacked by the bacteria. And upon attack of bacteria, the polymer that will get eroded, and that is responsible for releasing the drug candidate. The degradation of the polymer that will permits the release of the active drug. Polymers, examples are the glassy amylase that is mixed with the ethyl cellulose, isopolymers which will contain the nitrogen compound, guar gum, xanthan gum, cellulose acetate and the cellulose acetate halide. All these are the examples of the polymer which will be used in case of the colonic drug delivery system. The polymers that will be having their applicability in case of drug targeting. Now again, drug targeting, that is the new area where particularly we are making the drug to specifically go and act where it is required. So that is targeting the organ, that is targeting the system, that is targeting the tissue, that is targeting the cell, as it is having its wide applicability and it is mostly used in case of the cancerous patients, in the cancerous disorders where we want to have the effect of the drug only onto the cancerous cells and not onto the other host cells. So what the drug targeting is? The drug targeting is the ability of the drug to accumulate in the target organ. The target organ, that might be brain, that might be liver, that might be tissue, that might be cell, isn't it? Selectively and quantitatively. Selectively, it should go and it should accumulate only into the brain if the action is required into the brain, or into the liver if the action is required into the liver and not onto the other body part. That is said to be the selectively. Quantitatively, the large quantity of the drug that should get accumulated into the targeted organ. Independent of the site and methods of its administration. Whatever may be the route, whether we are taking it orally, whether we are taking it parenterally, whether we are taking it topically or by some any another route. Irrespective of the route of administration, the drug that should target to the organ, the drug that should target to the tissue, the drug that should selectively and quantitatively accumulate into the organ and the tissue, that is said to be the drug targeting. We can go for modifying the release of the dosage forms with the help of use of the polymers. So with the use of polymers in conventional dosage form, the release can be modified, and such a kind of dosage form are now called as the modified release dosage forms. Now what are the modified release dosage forms are, how these are going to be defined? It is defined as one for which the drug release characteristics of the time course and or location are chosen to accomplish therapeutic objectives not offered by the conventional dosage form. So this is the definition which is given by the United States Pharmacopoeia and the National Formulary. What it is, it will give the therapeutic objective which is not given by the conventional dosage form. In what way? In the way, in the characteristic fashion of time course and the location. That is the modified release dosage form. Now in this particular graph, you can see that it is the time versus plasma concentration. And here you can see the three different peaks. This is the first one, CR, this is the SR, and this is the PODF. What is the CR? That is the controlled release. This is the sustained release, and this is the conventional per oral dosage form. So what will happen in case of conventional peroral dosage form? When we are giving the drug, the drug concentration that will goes on increasing and it will going on decreasing. In case of sustained release, what we are doing, we are asking slowly to rise the concentration of the drug into the plasma concentration and to slowly go on reducing the plasma concentration in the sustained fashion. In case of the controlled release, suddenly there is an increase into the drug concentration which it reaches to the plasma concentration and it will get maintained constant level. That is the controlled release of the drug that could be done in this controlled release drug delivery system with the help of use of the polymers. Again, this is another figure. You can see that this is the conventional dosage form, which will require the frequency of dosing and the administration of the drug. So what are these peaks and valleys? So this is said to be the peak and these are said to be the valleys. Now what these peaks and valleys they will indicate? It will indicate that when we are giving the dose of the drug, its concentration that is going on decreasing, another there is a need to give the another dose. So here the three dosings are required in order to maintain the concentration into the effective plasma concentration. So this is the range which is between the CSS max and the CSS min. What is the CSS min? That is the steady state plasma concentration minimum, and CSS max is the steady state maximum plasma concentration. So we require the drug to remain into these two levels, between these two, right? So that is responsible for producing its therapeutic action. What will happen if the concentration that will go process the CSS max is responsible for producing the side effect, adverse effect, toxic effect, and when it will not achieve the minimum steady state plasma drug concentration, whereas if it will remain below that one, it will indicate that there is an under medication. So under medication will indicate that there is no therapeutic effect. So it is necessary to remain the concentration into this, for which we require the frequent dosing. Now this frequent dosing that will lead to the non-compliance. Sometimes if by mistake the patient may miss the second dose, so what will happen? This peak will go like this and again it will go like this. Or when we are giving another dose, when it will going touching to the bottom line, it may reach only up to this particular level and not beyond this, right? So again, the dosing may not be effective because it is under medication, it had not crossed the minimum plasma drug concentration, steady state plasma concentration. So for which we need to maintain the drug concentration between these two in order to give the therapeutic effect. So the polymers, they will be useful in case of maintaining the concentration into the therapeutic level, either in the form of modifying the dosage form or in the form of giving the dosage form in sustained release or in case of the controlled release form. The polymers, they are used as a drug targeting also. They will be having their advantages. The drug concentration in the target sites is increased without undesirable effect onto the non-target sites. Now the advantage is in the form of, say, patient compliance, right? This is, you can have a just look onto these two particular patient. This is first patient, this is second patient. This patient is distressed one, whereas this patient is happier one. Why it is? Because the drug that will get accumulated at a targeted site, at a targeted organ, whereas in this particular patient, the drug that is getting spread all over onto the body part. So that will give discomfort, that will give side effects, and that will give the adverse effect. As a result of which, the patient cannot remain the happy. Now, with the help of polymers, we can go for modifying the release pattern of the drug. So here you can see the pH-sensitive smart polymeric insulin delivery. So this is pH sensitive. The normal blood glucose level, that is the pH, is 7.4, but when the glucose that will get converted into the gluconic acid, as a result of release of the acid, the pH that will get decreased. So from 7.4 it will goes to the 4. Now as a result of which, what will happen? This material, this polymeric material, it will get eroded, or it will create the gaps between these locks. Between these, they will get release, or they will cause the release of this drug, that is the insulin, wherever it is required. Now, once this gluconic acid that will disappear, so again they will regain the pH 7.4, and there is an interlocking system which will get activated that will not allow to further release the insulin. So this is the way by which we can go for use of the polymers. These are said to be the pH sensitive polymeric material. Advanced alteration into the pH of the surrounding medium that will causes their degradation or creating the pores, opening of the pores and to release the drug content. Now this is what is all about the polymers and all. Now you can go for study of multiple examples of the polymers which are surrounding to you. You can go for selecting a particular kind of polymer just to go on studying what is its chemical nature, what are their physical properties, solubility, what are the grades, and how they will respond to the changes into the temperature, pH, and what are the major applications of the polymers. This will be useful for you to design, this will be useful for you to modify the dosage form. This will be also useful for you if you will go for the further higher studies like the M-Pharm and other things. Now after going through all these things in case of polymerization, what is the ultimate takeaway message that how we can go for utilizing these polymers? So the polymers and their polymerization properties that may be used to develop suitable dosage form with improved biopharmaceutical and the pharmacokinetic properties. Not all the study, not all the knowledge of these polymers that will be useful for us to modify and to design the properties of the dosage forms. That might be in the form of onset, duration, release and targeting can be modified by using the suitable polymers. We can go for use of the different kinds of polymers, and with the help of use of these polymers, we can modify all these parameters, onset, duration, release and the targeting of the drugs. So this is what is all about the process. This is what is all about the pre-formulation. So right from the first lecture till date, what particularly we saw in case of pre-formulation. Here particularly the details associated with the pre-formulation that are over.